This is Tairo Hassan from Brightline, a project management initiative. We are here at RISE and I will be having a conversation with Pascal Jobers from Fujitsu. And I will be talking more about where the future is taking us, where technology is taking us, and also trying to understand how to implement on strategies. Mm-hmm. But let's just start by asking Pascal, what is taking you or bringing you to a conference like RISE?
Good question. Well, what we see, it initiated with the Web Summit for us, and we see a more important role for startups in the relations with customers and corporates nowadays. So we are setting up things like accelerators in Japan and in the US and in Europe to support startups connecting to corporates. So part of the scouting process, but also to get into the ecosystem, it's important to have the right connections. So that's also why we participate in Web Summit.
Maybe if I can push you one more step on that one, the notion of product, service, and now I'm hearing more about experimentation or experience, customer experience is the word that is coming. Yeah. How do you bring that one in? Or how do you relate it to service, experience?
I really like this question because I really believe in these innovation approaches. I have an entrepreneurial background as well as a sort of strategy consulting background. So I have both of those kind of elements. And I know how hard it is to really test something also with customers. So the lean startup approach, for example, is something I really like with MVPs and then going to the next step and learning, validating also with customers. And I think what we see now is I see a sort of adoption of corporates in this world. So lean startup as an innovation kind of approach in a corporate, which is also sort of, I'm not sure if funny is the right word, but it's funny because they copy even these words. Yeah, so we are doing now MVPs, minimal viable products. I'm not sure if many people really understand what an MVP is, but they're trying to copy these kind of approaches and models. But also what they do is they take elements of this and they put it in the way they operate. Yes.
Your AI, machine learning, blockchain, I mean big data, you name it. If there is one or maybe two of them that you feel will shape or will kind of be the most disruptive organization, what technologies do you see being these disruptive?
I believe there are two ones. So the obvious one is also AI. Let me start with that one first. The reason why I believe that AI will become big is because we are doing so much effort now on AI. And if you look at AI, it's not a sort of container kind of word. It's more like small components which are becoming more mature. For example, recognizing objects in a video stream, recognizing people in photos, or so these components are becoming more mature and you can really build businesses out of this. Yeah, so a self-driving car, for example, they use these kind of technologies. So all these components are becoming more mature. Language translation, we even have now language translation integrated in apps and so on. So I think these components are becoming more mature over time, and this will build up all the capabilities over the next coming years. But the other one is, what for me is the new way of computing. The old world is more transistor-based kind of computing. We now see a lot of things going on quantum computing. For example, Fujitsu has a new technology called Digital Annealer, which sort of uses the quantum technology principles for traditional platforms already, so you can already build on these kind of things. And the interesting thing about this is that you can solve problems a different way. And let me give you an example. People are so used to solving problems a specific way that we don't even understand anymore that there are other ways. Just to give you an example, SSL encryption. We have now methodologies to encrypt data, SSL for example, which is based on a sort of model that you can't go back. If you have, secured data, you can't go back to the old, initial, original data because it's so much work to do. But it's only so much work to do because we use traditional computers. Yeah. So what if you have a new way of using mathematical problems and calculate them? Maybe it's just a press of a button, and you would be able to encrypt those kind of things. And we see that as well for a lot of other things. So we see new kind of models, also mathematical models that can now run differently on computer systems, which will speed up a lot of things which we were not able to do in the past. For example, drug discovery is also a good example. In the past, it was really difficult to do with more traditional computing, but we see now new ways of calculating opportunities also in parallel instead of serial. So we see new ways through these new kind of technologies.
I wasn't planning to ask it, but for quantum computing, when do you see it happening? 5, 10, 20 years?
Yes.
I also looking at your crystal ball.
Yeah, I always have to be a bit careful with this topic because we built also supercomputers and so on from Fujitsu, but we don't build a quantum computer at this moment. If I look at the market, I see different opinions on this. For me, it's not here yet. So I think it's under development. It's not really at a production level yet. So maybe 2025 to 2030, maybe we'll see the first signs of it. So that's also why we really believe in in-between steps, because you can already do things like this when you use digital annealing kind of approaches. You don't have to wait for the real quantum computing at the end. It's the same story as with AI. You don't have to wait for the ultimate AI in 20 years. Look at the things you already have. So let's start to use them and see how far you can get with them.
Wonderful, wonderful. In ending, I have one question for you regarding, let's say, teams. If there's one skill that you think that team needs to go or to execute on strategy in times of digital transformations, what would that skill be?
I think it's about it's a sort of intrinsic motivation to be flexible or agile or entrepreneurial. It's at the end, if things change so much, you need to be willing to change. If you have a lot of experts which are skilled in old technologies, they're not the wrong people for the future. They're all just on the wrong technology or maybe on the wrong methodology of doing things. So they need to be able to change to this new world and they adapt to this new world. But we also need to give them the opportunity to do so. Maybe I can give you a very good example of the things I like most. I was at the conference and I presented something on also on skills. And people ask me, what do you think about new people, because they're much more flexible into new technologies, and how do you deal with the older people and do you see a place for them? I said, this is, in my view, totally wrong question. Maybe the question is okay, but it assumes the wrong things, because let me give you an example. I ran a hackathon a couple of years ago and we had a lot of teams in this hackathon building new solutions. The one that won, I said to them, we'll take you to the sort of a startup event we have in the Netherlands. And the team that won was a team that built software on mainframes. That was the team that was the most agile team, and they adopted a sort of technology, I don't even care what it was at that time, and they built a solution out of that. And I took them to this event and they said to me, everybody tries to push our technology back because they don't believe in the future and so on. And so I said to them, you have to understand, you have a perfect team. You're just on the old wrong technology for us anymore. We don't want this technology anymore because it's not supported by the vendors anymore. It's too expensive for us. And of course, I understand you like this stuff, and maybe it's even good stuff. But if you look at all these startups, they now all use new technologies and so on. Please look around, pick the number three technologies you see, the top three, and select one of them and change your team to build on these technologies, and you will be the best team in this company. So it's not about age, it's about the will to adopt new technologies and to stay flexible. Don't think I'm there yet, I'm the top developer, or stay open for new technologies and try to change towards that, and also try to still always learn to what's going on so you can fit in. I think that's the most important one.
Pascal, thank you so much.
Yes.
Very much appreciated.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.